one last talk today, which is a contributed talk by Pararth Shah.
Hello. Hey, hi, I'm Pararth, and I'm working at Google on dialogue systems. So I'm not an expert on reinforcement learning either, and I think Jason's last answer just summarized my talk, basically. So the key ideas from my talk that I wish to put across are that it's difficult to design a reward function for dialogue systems, and using interactive feedback as a policy shaping mechanism can be advantageous over interpreting it as a numerical reward. So to start with, we'll look at some of the recent work in dialogue systems, which uses two-stage training with a supervised learning phase, which bootstraps the dialogue manager on a corpus of dialogues collected with a human expert. So the dialogue manager is trained to imitate the human expert. And then this is followed by a reinforcement learning phase, which refines the dialogue manager's strategies by allowing it to interact with the user simulator. This is similar to how AlphaGo has approached the game of Go. And it has benefits that it leads to faster convergence in the RL phase, because the supervised learning phase reduces the action space and reduces the action space that it needs to explore. And also the RL phase makes it possible to bootstrap from a very small expert data set. However, as in contrast to AlphaGo, there are certain issues with using this in dialogue. So one thing is there is a reality gap between a user simulator and an actual user. And the other thing is it's difficult to design a reward function. So let's look at a sample dialogue between a user and an assistant, like a dialogue agent, which is helping the user find a restaurant. This is a successful dialogue because the user found a restaurant that matched their constraints, and also their information requests were satisfied. Now, this is another dialogue with the same user goal. But over here, we can see that the assistant is not able to satisfy the user's request immediately. And only after the user formulates the request in a certain manner is the assistant able to handle the request. So even though both the dialogues have successful task completion, clearly the second one is suboptimal, because the user had to try multiple times before they could get the system to do what they want. So looking into why this is the case, a common approach to using RL for dialogue systems is to design a task-level reward, which is given at the end of the task. And that the reward is defined as, if the task is complete, then give a reward of +1 minus a small penalty for every turn that the dialogue manager took to complete the task, and otherwise give a negative reward. However, this formulation gives almost similar rewards to both the dialogues that we just saw. So it does not punish the bad turns that happened in the dialogue. There is an issue of credit assignment, because the reward is given at the end of the dialogue. So the dialogue manager will need to do a lot of exploration to finally figure out the correct sequence of moves that would optimize the reward further. And this is also brittle, because the notion of task completion is unclear if the dialogue has gone through a trajectory that was not covered by the system designer in his definition of task completion. Another option is to define ad hoc rules to evaluate each turn. So this would punish each turn if it did a mistake. So for example, here are some example rules, like, did the system answer the information requests? Did the system take into account all constraints, et cetera? However, this does not scale, because there can be a lot of rules that define sensible conversational strategies. Taking a step back, the overall problem is, how do we avoid walking into walls in a conversation? So here in Atari, in this game of Pac-Man, when the agent reaches the lowest row, it knows that it cannot go any further, because the emulator restricts the actions that are possible in any state. What we need is an Atari for dialogue, where we can restrict the actions that are sensible in a state. But this is not straightforward, because there are a lot of different rules that apply, and all the rules are implicit in dialogue. And we also don't have well-defined rewards. While in over here, it's clear when the agent eats something or gets killed. So essentially, dialogue is a game without a well-defined set of rules. The Atari games have their dynamics, the game of Go has its rules, and also in robot simulations, even though it is difficult to simulate the real world completely, the laws of physics still provide a lot of structure to what can happen in the simulated world. While for dialogue, we don't have a concise set of rules for doing that. So it's difficult to come up with a simulation environment that can tackle that. However, what is true for dialogue is that all the rules are implicitly known by all the humans who know how to talk. So we can leverage that by introducing the human into the loop. And when the dialogue system is actually deployed in front of users, we note the feedback given by the human at each turn and incorporate this into the task level reward. So feedback can be explicit if we have instructed the users to provide feedback to us, or it can be implicit where we do sentiment analysis on the user's turn to know if the user has a bad experience. Now, there are two ways to interpret this feedback. One is as a reward value. So if this is the MDP, we could add the feedback as additional rewards to the turns. So the F values are the feedback rewards, while the R value is the task level reward at the end of the dialogue. And the dialogue manager or the agent policy optimizes the combined reward. Another option is to use it as a label on the previous action. So the policy can identify that if a turn got a negative feedback, then the previous action was not optimal, and so it should not do that action when it reaches that state again. And this is what we are focusing on currently. So we are using this formulation from a previous work from Griffith, where we define the feedback to be a minus one or a plus one label on a state action pair. We accumulate the feedback over multiple turns, and this is the delta for that state action pair. And this is the formulation for estimating how optimal the feedback is for that given state, where C is an estimate of consistency of the feedback, and we say so for high scores of C, we are trusting the user's feedback to be consistent with the optimal policy. And so for example, for C equal to 0.95, the feedback can be, if the delta is zero, then this formula gives 0.5. And if delta is -3, it gives a really low value. And +3, it gives a really high value. So we use this as an additional policy where initially when there is no feedback, the agent depends on the reward policy. And as it makes mistakes and accumulates feedback, the feedback policy will get more information and it'll shape the agent's reward. So here are a couple of reasons why this is better. Feedback policy can be arbitrary. It doesn't need to be potential based. And also it shapes the exploration policy strategy, which makes it faster to converge and also safer in deployed systems. So I'm skipping over the experiments. Happy to talk about it offline. There are a lot of open questions which this brings up about how do we model the implicit feedback, how do we learn from demonstrations, and also can we model the feedback policy as a neural network when we incorporate a lot of feedback labels. And so in summary, this is what we're proposing, where we have combined benefits of supervised learning followed by reinforcement learning simulations. And then in actual deployment, we have a combined policy for turn level feedback and task level reward. So this is similar to how humans learn, which is through imitation, experimentation, and feedback. Thank you.
Any questions?
Hi. Thanks for a great talk. So I have a question. So this is basically still like a policy module learning, right? So you supervise the policy component and also apply reinforcement learning on it. But Jason's work is more on like this end-to-end fashion. And yeah. Do you think that if you use this modular pipeline, you don't have the capability to learn this language on the understanding component from, for example, the feedback of users, right? So what is your opinion about that?
Yeah, that's a great point. So we are focusing on a modular component because that's easier to bootstrap off of small data sets. But even, so the idea would be to have a separate model that learns to map a user's feedback, a user's turn to a numerical feedback value. But an alternative is to have it end-to-end and have the same model incorporate the textual feedback into the system. So
this is also something you are like looking into now?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay, let's thank the speaker. And with that, I will turn it over to Sergey.